I want to talk to you today about a very important topic. That's uncertainty. By the way, show of hands, who here feels like the world is uncertain? I'm just curious. I see a lot of hands. So here's what I do. I study this question of innovation, disruption, change, transformation. I've written 5 books on the topic and many articles. And here's the thing that always puzzled me. We talk about innovation. We talk about disruption. We'll even admire the great changes that an innovator creates, the new business, the new opportunity, the change in the world. We talk about those things, but we never talk about another critical element, which is that to do that new thing, the innovator first had to step into the unknown. They had to first face uncertainty. And how do we do that well? That's my fundamental question. I believe it's an important question. According to some sources, uncertainty is on the rise. So this is the World Uncertainty Index, put together by economists at Stanford and the IMF. And what it suggests is that uncertainty has been increasing for several decades. But here's the thing. I don't care if you think it's going up or down. The issue I'm here to talk about is how does it feel? How does it feel to face uncertainty? And I think the former CEO of Ben & Jerry's puts it well. He said, listen, the world now is paradox. There's ambiguity and paradox everywhere. For people who like the linear route forward, life is getting harder and harder in any field. So that's the core issue. I don't know about you, but I was taught the linear route forward. Maybe you had a better school than I had. Maybe you had better parents than I had, and they taught you how to navigate uncertainty. But I believe very few of us have been taught how to navigate uncertainty well. So we're here to talk about ideas, right? And I'm telling you that one of the most fundamental factors we face in our lives and business, uncertainty, we don't have the skills to do well. That's probably a big idea. That's probably a big deal. And it's a big deal because when we don't have skills to face uncertainty, we fall into some well-documented traps. We get rigid in the face of threat. We feel anxious. We overreact. We ruminate. We make a decision. Turns out it wasn't maybe the right decision. And we stress and we think and we ruminate about it too long. Well, here's the good news. The good news is we can get better. There's empirical evidence in the fields of ambiguity tolerance and uncertainty avoidance and resilience that all highlight that, number one, you can learn this, and number two, people who learn it, they're more creative, they're better entrepreneurs, they're better managers. But I'll tell you a little secret. The reason I care so much about this question is because I'm not very good at facing uncertainty. I'm scared by uncertainty. I struggle with it. So when I went out to this research, what I found was missing was, how do I get better? Help me. Give me some tools so that I have the courage to do new things, so I have the courage to lead an organization through a crisis. And so that was the focus of our research. We went out and we interviewed people who had faced the unknown, great innovators, Nobel Prize-winning scientists, but also people from other walks of life. For example, paramedics or gamblers or surfers or startup investors, and asked what tools have they developed to face the unknown. The framework we come up with is fairly simple. Really, three parts. Number one, every achievement that we admire, recall that it only came after first facing uncertainty. In fact, I would challenge you, think about your own life. Think about the achievements you're proud of. I bet it only came after you took a risk, after you stepped into the unknown, after you did something different. So if that's true, then really, uncertainty and possibility are two sides of the same coin, aren't they? If we want possibility, if we want growth, if we want change, if we want transformation, we're going to have to learn to face uncertainty. But here's the second part. We don't just get to choose uncertainty. Uncertainty happens to us as well. And you all learned this during the COVID pandemic, didn't you? Nobody would choose it. It happened to us. It's the unplanned uncertainty. And it can feel incredibly stressful. We all have a recent memory of that. Maybe even a recent memory of yesterday, of all the stress that's going on in the world. But here's the thing. Even though it looks very turbulent, if we believe uncertainty and possibility are two sides of the same coin, then even in that unplanned uncertainty, the uncertainty we would not choose, there might still be some possibility to pull out of that. And the symbol for me that helps me remember this is actually one of your most beautiful cities, and that's Venice. Here's this architectural gem, rare and unique in all the world, yet we forget that it only exists because of 300 years of uncertainty, as invaders threaten the people on shore, forcing them into the lagoon, turning them into a naval power, leading to this. That's a metaphor for our lives. We face something we wouldn't want to face, but there's some possibility we can pull out of it. And number three, there are tools. There are tools to face uncertainty. And in fact, there's more than 30. Now, don't worry, I'm not going to talk you through 30 tools. You'd be really tired after I was done. But I want to talk you through the four categories of things to do. So we organized all these tools around a first aid cross for uncertainty with four arms or four categories of things to do when facing uncertainty. And that's number one, reframe in terms of not the uncertainty, but the possibility. Number two, you can prime or prepare. Number three, there are ways to take action. Research has shown us that lead to better outcomes in uncertainty. And number four, sustain yourself and your teams. So I'm going to talk you through all four of those. I'm going to talk to you at an individual level, but it clearly has organizational implications. Why? Because to lead uncertainty, it starts with you. It starts with your ability, your uncertainty ability that you can build to be calm in the face of the unknown. So I want to help you build that. So I'm going to focus mostly on personal examples, and then I'll give you some examples of it applying in an organization. So this first category of reframe, again, reframing in terms of the possibility, not just the uncertainty. It sounds kind of soft, but it's actually based on a deep science in the fields of psychology and behavioral economics. And it's this core idea. The way we frame something or the way we describe it shapes how we think, decide, and act. That's the whole idea. In fact, it was demonstrated in a Nobel Prize-winning study where they gave participants two treatments for a disease. Treatment A had a 5% chance of failure. Treatment B had a 95% chance of success. They're identical. Nonetheless, people always choose the 95% chance of success. Why? Because we are wired by evolution to be gain-seeking and loss-averse. We want to win. We don't want to lose. Well, why is this so important? Well, if you believe me that uncertainty and possibility are two sides of the same coin, if we only frame in terms of the uncertainty, we won't get to the other side of the coin. We will not get to the possibility. That's the core idea. So I want to help you shift from feeling like, oh, uncertainty is too scary for me, from I'm not good at it, I'm terrible at it, to I am capable, I'm on the verge of possibility. Let me give you an example. Some friends of ours were expats in Paris. COVID hit, and they lost their jobs. They didn't have a job at home. They didn't know where they were going to live. They didn't have a job in France. The only thing they knew is they had airplane tickets in 3 days to fly back to the U.S. That's the only thing they knew. And they were terrified. They were freaking out. They had children. I have four children. They're teenagers. They had teenagers, and their teenagers were saying things like, "You're the worst parents ever." Yeah. Just like a teenager to know where to stick the knife, right? You're the worst parents ever. You don't know, you don't even have a job. What's wrong with you? And my co-author, who's also my wife of 26 years, she's an entrepreneur and an innovator, she sat down with this couple and said, "You know, maybe it's not that. Maybe you need to go back to those teenagers and tell them you are having the courage to wait for the right thing to appear, to stand on the edge of the unknown, and to not have to prematurely grab onto something certain, but instead wait for the right opportunity to come." And she walked out of that meeting. It was a couple, and the woman in that couple, she walked out of that meeting encouraged, ready to fly home, ready to find new opportunities instead of feeling stressed and anxious. And about 3 weeks later, we got this text back that basically said, "Everything worked out. We got jobs, we found a place to live, the kids are happy." That's kind of the nature of life, right? In the moment, it feels so uncertain, like we have to resolve it immediately. And in fact, if we wait, if we could reframe it in terms of the possibility, it would make that waiting easier. Now, I've given you a very individual example, but this applies to companies too, to you as leaders. So let's think about framing uncertainty and possibility in the context of a company. During COVID, I got to see how many different organizations responded to this great uncertainty we all faced. And there were leaders who said things like, "This is the worst thing that's ever happened to us. This is worse than the Great Depression." Now, how do you think people in that company felt when they heard that? They start to freak out. And all the energy that could be put towards work starts going towards anxiety. The energy starts circling the drain of anxiety. They're checking their bank accounts. Can I pay my rent? You know, can I find another job? I want you to compare that framing with that of Brian Chesky, who was CEO of Airbnb. Now, for context, Airbnb lost 80% of their business. That's 80%, 80% of their business in 8 weeks. If anybody had a reason to complain, this is the worst thing that's ever happened to us. It's them, right? It's them. Did he say that? No. He said, this is our moment. Great companies are forged in moments of crisis. This is our chance to show who we are and what we're made of. Now, when I frame it that way, don't you feel different? Less of your energy is going towards anxiety, and more is going to asking, what can we do about this? How can we move forward? How can we face this crisis with courage? And in fact, behind the scenes, Brian Chesky said, you know, the hardest thing to manage in a crisis isn't your company. It's your own thoughts. As a leader, you can think all is doomed. You can ask, why me? You can get paralyzed, or you can tell yourself, this is my defining moment. It will leave indelible marks. Listen, he faced an unplanned uncertainty, something none of us would ever choose, to lose 80% of your business. And how did he frame it? He framed it in terms of the possibility. This is our chance to show our character. That's what I mean by framing in terms of the possibility, not the uncertainty. That's the core idea of the reframe tools. Now, the tools themselves are to help you do that well. And so I want to walk you through one of these tools. And now I'll just highlight that if you think this is too soft, there's empirical evidence that shows that companies that frame in terms of the possibility do better in the face of disruption. So there was this very interesting matched pair case study of how two U.S.-based booksellers, the dominant booksellers were Borders and Barnes & Noble, how they faced the uncertainty of the internet and of a new competitor called Amazon who threatened to take away their business. Now, Borders went out of business. Barnes & Noble survived. And what did this paper conclude was the reason? It was that Barnes & Noble framed the disruption not in terms of the uncertainty, but in terms of the possibility. The possibility to use the internet to serve our customers in new ways. Because they did that, people put their energy towards, hey, yeah, what could we do, instead of worrying. Okay, so again, that's the core idea. We write about all these tools to help you do that. So if it's okay, I want to give you one of these tools to help you practice reframing right now. And the tool I want to share with you is called Frontiers. What is a frontier, right? A frontier is that boundary between the unknown and the familiar. And most of us, let's be honest, we like to stay far back from the frontier in our lives. We want to stay where it's safe and calm and comfortable. But here's the thing. Innovators and creators, they see the frontier differently. They frame it in terms of where the zone where they will do their best work. And I want to give you an example of that. David Hyatt is an entrepreneur, a creator who lives in the UK. He'd been very successful in advertising. He built his own clothing brand, then sold it to Timberland. And he moved out to the west coast of Wales, to a little teeny tiny town. And when he gets there, he discovers this was once the jeans manufacturing headquarters of the UK. But those jobs had fled overseas 20 years ago. And he realizes, wait a minute. What if I could take the skills of the people in this town and my knowledge of how to create clothing brands to rejuvenate this city? So I think it's a powerful example of stepping onto the frontier, and I want him to share it in his own words.
thing, I've always loved business, but I've always thought that business can do good. And I think I've always thought that a business could be a tool for some kind of change that you believed in. Back in 1986, I arrived on Paddington train station and I had to go looking for work. And I got a job in advertising at a place called Saatchi & Saatchi. But I decided to myself that actually I climbed the wrong mountain. It was a beautiful mountain, but it was the wrong mountain. And that's why I quit London and wanted to get back to Wales. And the way to do that was by actually starting my own businesses. I asked myself, what am I going to go and do now? What do I do well? What does this town do well? And actually the answer was, it made jeans. It was the biggest and best jeans factory in Britain, bar none. And in 2001, those gates closed. But those makers still had all the skills. And for me, if we go out of this town making jeans again, and we get 400 people their jobs back, and we go and prove actually you can make in Britain, and you can do it really, really well, then we'll have done a really great job. I've never been into that thing of just like, let's build a business to make a ton of money. But I've been really driven by actually, let's go make a ton of change. And I guess that's what drives me.
It's an inspiring story. An example of somebody who stepped onto the frontier. In a way, the frontier was really scary, right? Because he was going to do something in a place where it had already failed. The great news is he succeeded and he's managed to get people their jobs back and build one of the most beloved brands in clothing. And when we asked him about the uncertainty of doing that, the uncertainty, facing the uncertainty of trying something that had already failed, he said, it was very simple for him. He said, you can only do your best work when you're at the frontier. You have to be at the frontier if you want to do something new. So think about that. You have to be at the frontier to do your best work. Friends, I'm here because I want you to do your best work in your life and your organization. That's why I wrote this book. It's not a pandemic book. It started a decade or two ago. So I want to ask you, think about the frontiers in your life. Maybe their career, maybe their relationship, maybe it's social or emotional or even entertainment. You don't have to step onto all the frontiers at once, but step onto one frontier. You might be surprised. I am constantly surprised. Recently, I stepped onto the entertainment frontier. I went to a performance by the English National Ballet of a very well-known ballet called Giselle in Paris, but it was unique in that they had invited this gentleman from Bangladesh, Akram Khan, to reimagine this very familiar ballet using the dance form of Northern India. It was the most transformational experience of my life in dance. It made me rethink, why am I living my life for? What's the purpose? Like, that's what can happen when you step onto the frontier. Maybe it's career. Maybe it's that challenging task or that challenging move. Whether it succeeds or fails, that's where you're going to do your best work. So that's my challenge. By the way, organizations have frontiers as well. And organizations that innovate recognize they have to step on the frontier to do it. So Talis is a very technical company providing applications for space and high-performance applications. But they recognize that while in the core of their business, they need to be very reliable, if they want to do something new, they're going to have to take a risk. So guess what? Companies have frontiers too. Maybe a frontier of product or customer or thought leadership. Let me give you an example of stepping onto the frontier as a company. I spent some time with the former CEO of the Eurostar back when Eurostar was losing money. In fact, when he took over, they had lost 208 million euros the year before, and there had been a fire in the tunnel, so they did not even have service. It was his job to turn it around. He told me that what they discovered when they looked into it is that the Eurostar connecting London and Paris, it's very popular with business travelers, but the leisure class was always empty. And so they said, well, we got to sell more leisure class tickets. And they performed some marketing studies and created some customer segmentations and then launched marketing campaigns to sell more leisure class tickets. But it didn't work. And he said, we struggled with that until we stepped onto the frontier with our customer. And he said, what we did is we took all our marketing studies and we put them in the drawer, and we went out and we had dinner with our customers. We sat with them. We spent time in their homes. And what we realized is that we were not selling train tickets. That's not how they thought about the world. Instead, they had a few extra £100 or euros, and they were asking, do I want to take the kids to Harry Potter World or, you know, where, you know, Disneyland Paris? And he said, what we had to do is we had to sell Paris, not train tickets. So we needed to bundle those tickets with train tickets from London to Paris, with, say, a ride on the boats that go up and down the Seine River, or maybe an onward journey to the lavender fields in the south. He said, when we did that, we sold out. We sold all the leisure class tickets, and we started to turn a profit. So again, stepping onto the frontier. You know, you've been listening to me for a while. Let's actually have some fun with this, right? I want you to turn to a neighbor, and I want you to share a story of someone who you admire who stepped onto the frontier. What did they do? How did they do it? Why do you admire them? It could be a hero that you have, somebody, you know, who's no longer alive, who you admire. I really love, like, Richard Feynman, the physicist, for example. It could be a personal relationship, a friend. I'll give you an example. So when I moved to France 7 years ago, when I got the offer to join INSEAD, INSEAD's one of the top business schools in the world, it was kind of a dream. You know, top business school, I'd always wanted to live in Europe, and here's the chance. But it was a very hard decision, because actually, we had a very comfortable situation at home. So I was at a good university, I had tenure, which is the job for life, I had kids, I had one, my oldest was in high school, so that's like later education, like you don't usually move kids. You know, my in-laws, my wife's parents lived up the street. Ah, man, how do I justify disrupting all that? And I asked people for advice, and my grandmother gave me some of the best advice I'd ever received. She said it to me very simply. She was a very colorful person, a real agent for social change in her communities. And she said to me, Nathan, parents teach their children to live their dreams when the parents live their dreams. And I was like, that's it. I have to do this. I would regret the rest of my life not trying. So that's, to me, I admire her as somebody who steps onto the frontier. So let's take 3-4 minutes, turn to one neighbor, and share with them a story of somebody you admire who stepped onto the frontier. Let's have some fun. Go ahead, talk to your neighbor. 30 seconds more. All right. Let's have you wrap up your conversations. Thanks to those of you who stepped into the unknown and shared with a neighbor a story of somebody who stepped onto a frontier. I hope it energized you. I hope you felt excited by that idea of how they did something uncertain. And what I would say is, if they're alive, I would encourage you to tell them. This idea of reframing that I've been talking about is so important. And I want to emphasize how important it is at a personal and organizational level, even for the uncertainties we do not choose. And if it's okay, I want to share a personal story of how I use these tools. So when we were writing this book, The Upside of Uncertainty, and we were in the middle of writing it, my second son was hospitalized for a manic episode. So and after he was hospitalized, they put him on these medications that turned him into a zombie. He was catatonic, he was incredibly depressed, and we spent the summer, which I had hoped would be a relaxing summer. I needed some vacation after COVID. I needed some vacation after writing this book. I really needed it. And instead, we spent every day trying to keep our son alive. And we didn't know what to do as parents. We didn't know, like, is he getting the right treatment? What's the right thing to do for him? It was so terrifying and discouraging. And we had booked some vacation in the south of France on the ocean, and we couldn't cancel it. So we couldn't leave him alone either. So we brought him with us. And to give you a sense of his despair, here we are, like lying by the ocean, all these other couples, no kids, you know, in their swimming suits. And our son is between my wife and I in a full black sweatshirt, pants, and high top shoes, just lying there every day, not looking at his phone, not listening to music. And every day we just tried to give him some reason to live. And I remember we'd been there a week and it's very hot. So I went and I jumped into the ocean to cool off. And I heard this splash behind me. And it was my son. And I was so happy that he had gotten up. And then he started to swim, and I'll be honest with you, I swam after him because I didn't know if he would stop. And thankfully, he stopped and touched the buoy and came back. And the next day, he swam to two buoys and came back. And then a few days after that, we were eating dinner. I'll always remember this. Chicken and Parmesan plate, and he smiled for the first time in months. And as I look back on that period, where we faced so much uncertainty about how to help this son, I remember my co-author and wife reminding me, reframe this in terms of the possibility. And I kept saying, there's no possibility here. This is all misery. But she was actually right. Because thankfully, he made it through. It's not always the case. Thankfully, he made it through. And something marvelous happened. And that is, my teenage son knows that his father loves him. I don't know if there's a bigger possibility I could get than that. Thank you, by the way. And that's why I feel so impassioned about these tools, because I know that we face so much uncertainty. So how can we get better at it? Well, let me tell you about the second category of tools, which is about priming or preparing. Think about how you prime a pump so that water comes out, or you prime the wall before you paint it so the paint sticks. That's the idea. How do we prepare in advance so when the uncertainty happens to us, we're calmer, we have more courage? Well, one of the tools I want to share with you that kind of surprised me was this idea of uncertainty balancers. So when you interview innovators, they will say things like, I love uncertainty. Uncertainty's fuel for me. One woman we interviewed said, I eat uncertainty for breakfast. And I was like, I don't. Not me. I don't eat uncertainty for breakfast. I'd rather not have it for breakfast, lunch, or dinner. But here's what's surprising. When you really dig in and really ask questions, that may be what they say on the front stage. But on the backstage, something different is happening. On the backstage, they're engaged in some remarkable activities to create certainty for themselves. So, for example, that woman who said, I eat uncertainty for breakfast, she actually carried with her a little bag of granola so that she had the same exact breakfast wherever she was in the world. Paul Smith, the designer who's known for his bold, colorful combinations, would stay in the same hotel room wherever he traveled. Not just the same hotel, the exact same room. Remember Barack Obama, he said, I have gray and blue suits, so I never have to think about what to wear. We interviewed the CEO of Match.com, it's a dating service, when they disrupted themselves with Tinder. And he said, uncertainty's fuel for me. But when we dug in, it turns out he said, well, I guess it's true that I did marry my high school sweetheart and all my friends are from middle school. Given how much uncertainty I traffic in at work, I don't like much uncertainty in my personal life. So what we observed is that there are all these tactics you can use to balance out the uncertainty in your life. And these are things like habits, routines, and rituals. They're outsourcing and simplification, humor and sarcasm, but most importantly, relationships and communities. So for example, if you're listening to me and saying, Nathan, you're telling me uncertainty is good, but or there's a good side to it, but I have way too much in my life, or my organization has way too much, I would really encourage you, think about, is there an uncertainty balancer you can introduce into your life that would help you, help your organization? So for example, one of my executive students, she helps lead an electric vehicle charging startup. So they're building the infrastructure to charge electric vehicles. Living in that organization is like being on a roller coaster. You know, one day the regulators say they're gonna do something that helps you. The next day they delay it for 6 months. And it's all these ups and downs, all this uncertainty. And she said, one of the things we do at our company to balance the uncertainty is every Friday we get together, we talk about what did we feel, what were our emotions, what were the challenges, how do we face it, and then we go out and get drinks. Very simple. She said, that one thing, whenever we do an evaluation of what to do and what to stop, what to keep, what to stop, that's the number one thing. So I would just encourage you. Don't worry, I won't make you talk to your neighbor, but I would encourage you to say, what's the temperature of uncertainty in my life or in my company? Is there an uncertainty balancer I could introduce that would help me face the unknown? Hertz is sponsoring part of this event, and I was speaking to Massimo yesterday, and he talked about how he just sent out an inspirational idea every day during COVID, and that actually helped because it just helped people remember it's not all frightening. There's opportunity as well. Okay, so that's the idea behind priming or preparing. Uncertainty balancers is just one of the tools to do that. So I want to talk to you about this third category of things. How do we take action? Uncertainty can be paralyzing, but taking action is one of the best ways to resolve the unknown. But there are better ways to take action than others. For example, some of the more obvious things are to take the uncertainty you face and break it down into small steps. Break it down into a series of experiments rather than one big mega project. That's probably my number one piece of advice. Break it down into small steps. But my guess is that's kind of intuitive for most of you. So I want to share something a little unusual. And that is a tool we call Activate and Unlock. So as you know, I work in a business school. Business school and management is about organization. It's about control. And we even talk about risk and managing risk. And I want to be clear, there is a place for risk management. If you're running a factory, I want people to be safe. That's a great place to control the risk. I am not suggesting we have more uncertainty on the factory floor. Oh, I might get run over. Yikes. Not that. But here's the thing. When I went out and talked to innovators about this, I originally called this project, The Upside of Uncertainty, I talked about how do you manage uncertainty. And I got the most surprising response. Many of these innovators would say, oh, I love uncertainty. I love the topic. I don't like that word managing. And I just kept ignoring them. They don't know what they're talking about. They don't know what they're talking about. Until my co-author handed me an article that kind of changed my perspective. It was about a very famous architect, a landscape architect. His name was Roberto Burle Marx. Very fundamental actor in the field. Changed the direction of modern architecture. And he talked about the turning point in his career was when he was a student in Berlin. And he went to the local horticultural center where they were doing an exhibit on the plants from his native country. He originally came from Brazil. So he's in Germany seeing the plants from home. And he's noticing that these brilliant, colorful plants, they're so vibrant, they're so powerful, and yet they've been put in these little pots and planters, and they're literally breaking out. And he asks himself the question, what if the real question is not how do we manage and control it, but how do we activate and unlock the potential of what's there? For me, that sparked something. Maybe that's what these innovators were trying to tell me. Uncertainty isn't about managing and controlling. It's about activating and unlocking the possibility of what's there. So I started to look around. By the way, if you don't know Roberto Burle Marx, you've probably seen his sidewalk, the Copacabana sidewalk, very famous. But I started to look around, and I started to find examples. And actually, one of my favorite examples is one of your composers, Vivaldi. Very interesting fellow, by the way. He essentially worked at an orphanage in Venice, and one of the many of the children who were brought to them could be taught trades, could go on and live a normal life, but there were certain people that society rejected. And it was usually because they had some sort of sickness, like they were scarred by smallpox, for example. And they couldn't find a trade, and nobody wanted to take them into their family. So he wrote music for them. And he turned them into some of Europe's finest musicians. But they always performed behind a curtain to hide those deformities that society had rejected. And in fact, there's this great story about how Jean-Jacques Rousseau, the famous French philosopher, was so taken with the beauty of the music. He was sure that these players were equally beautiful. He called them angels. And because he was so powerful, he was able to get an audience and have the curtain dropped, and he was shocked by what he saw. And I just share that because I think it's amazing that Vivaldi was able to take people that society had rejected and turn them into the best musicians in Europe. He was able to activate and unlock the potential of what was there. So that's an example for me. And, you know, many of us, by the way, all know Vivaldi's Four Seasons. We're probably tired of it. Could you activate and unlock that? Four Seasons. Well, Max Richter is a very famous modern composer, and he asked the question, could I? He said, you know, we've all heard Vivaldi. We hear it in the grocery store. You hear it everywhere. We're kind of tired of it, but it's really beautiful. And he asked this question, could I take those opening bars? Could I loop it? Could I make it like a dance music? What could I do with it that would activate and unlock the potential of what's there? And I'll share with you a very brief audio segment of what he created. I hate to have to pause it. It's beautiful. It reopens that beautiful creation for you. It activates and unlocks it. And you know, Max Richter afterwards, he was very respectful of the original. He said, you know, I was just trying to find one new way to engage with it. You know, there's a philosopher modern philosopher, his name is John O'Donohue, who said something really beautiful I love. He said, you know, we always see facts as so permanent, but we always forget for every fact, there were 1, 2, 10, 100 possibilities in the background that didn't happen to get elected as the fact. And what I love about that, he's kind of challenging the concreteness of the things around us and asking, what's possible? Well, I love this idea. So I started to go investigate and ask, are there some things that are better activated and unlocked rather than managed and controlled? And one of the first things that came up was Maria Montessori, the first woman to graduate from the medical school at the University of Rome. Her big project was to take children who had learning disabilities that society had written off. They'd been put into institutions where they were given medication to manage and control them. Not my words, the words of the historians. She asked a question. If I gave these children activities that would spark their natural curiosity, would they learn? And what she found is not only did they learn, they preferred to learn to their toys and to other activities. And they were able to pass the state exams just like children who had not been classified as having learning disabilities. And her style of learning, or a Montessori education, has spread around the world. And it's funny, she said, I did not invent a method of education. I simply gave some little children a chance to live. Okay, so maybe it works in education. What about business? Could it ever work in business? Well, there's this very interesting organization called Valve Software. It was founded by a gentleman by the name of Gabe Newell. Gabe Newell was working at Microsoft in the 90s, and they did a survey to find out what's the most installed software across the globe. You know they expected it to be Microsoft Windows, right? That's what they expected. But when the results came back, they were shocked. Microsoft Windows was number two. What was the number one most installed software across the world? It was a video game. A video game called Doom, created by eight people in the middle of nowhere in Texas. And Gabe Newell said, if eight people could beat the might of Microsoft, could create the most installed software in the world, maybe we're doing something wrong. And so he created Valve, and at Valve, you do not get a job title, you do not get a role, you're given a desk with wheels on it and told, move it to where you create the most value for customers. Pretty radical idea, but they've had a lot of success. And the way they talk about it is, why go recruit some of the smartest people in the world, then put them in a box and tell them what to do? Instead, how do we activate and unlock their native intelligence and creativity? You know, I see this around transformation. I got to interview Ralph Hommers when he led the transformation of ING, the global bank, from a traditional bank to a digital bank. And when he talked about what was the essence of leading that transformation, he said, I went back to our DNA, which was about innovation and simplicity. And he said, all I had to do is touch it to activate it, not my words, his, to activate this identity, who we are and what we're about, and everybody could see it, believed in it, move forward. So maybe even we activate and unlock around, you know, transformation. I have so many examples here about, for example, how the world's top chefs innovate, but what I'd love to do is just have you consider where you're sitting right now. How do I tap into the inherent capability of the people around me? How would I activate and unlock it? You may have heard people talking about agile, an agile organization. Maybe some of you even do it. It's basically this idea of creating small teams that are empowered from beginning to end to get something done. Usually we call them a scrum or a squad or and here's the thing I wonder about that. Is the magic of agile all the structural pieces? Or is the magic really that you're just tapping into, you're activating and unlocking people's native intelligence? Turns out most of us know what we should do. We know the right way to solve the problem we're facing. We don't need to be managed and controlled. So, in summary, when I talk about these tools around doing, remember the stuff you already know about breaking it into small steps or small experiments. Remember about the value of learning quickly. But I would really push you, ask, how do I activate and unlock what the potential is here, rather than trying to manage and control it away? Okay. Last category of tools, sustain. Listen, if you go into uncertainty, you're going to face setbacks, changes, frustration, and sustain is about navigating that well. You notice, by the way, that we chose a symbol for each arm of the first aid cross. So the North Star for reframing in terms of the possibility, the backpack for preparing, the sailboat, which catches the wind for dew. And for sustain, we chose the coat of arms of the city of Paris, which is everywhere. You've been there, you've seen it. Very, very meaningful, though, because it's a boat on turbulent water, and the Latin translated to English, tossed, not sinking. I love that image. I mean, as a city, Paris has faced every kind of uncertainty you could imagine, tragedy you could imagine, famine, war, plague, everything. It's been tossed, but it hasn't sunk. It's emerged, nonetheless, the city of light. So that's the metaphor I want you to have for yourself. I may feel tossed, but I won't sink. So how do you sustain yourself? One of the tool categories is reality check. It's about just unpacking, challenging the nature of reality. We had this great conversation to illustrate this with Ben Feringa. He won the Nobel Prize in Chemistry in 2016. And he emphasized that, again, doing anything new is about facing uncertainty. But he said, you know, if you face uncertainty, you will fail. That's just the nature of it. You will get frustrated. You have to get good at facing frustration. Not ignore it. Allow yourself to feel it for a few days, but then ask, what can I learn from it? So I want to give you some tools to take a frustrating circumstance and see it differently. I'm going to share with you the work of Martin Seligman. So Martin Seligman is a professor at the University of Pennsylvania, and his early work was about what we call learned helplessness. And what he found is if they put these dogs into a room, a closed room, and they would shock them, in the next round of the experiment, they would repeat the experiment, but the next time they would have a little low barrier. The dog would get shocked. If the dog jumped over the barrier, the dog could get to a space where the dog would be safe. No shock. I know, sad experiment for people who love dogs. So, but what they found is even when they gave the dogs a way to escape, the dogs never jumped over. They had learned to be helpless. So they could jump over the barrier, but they didn't. In fact, the experimenters had to literally drag the dog over the barrier 7 to 8 times before the dog learned, oh, I can get out of this terrible situation. Well, Martin Seligman said, I think this probably happens with people too. So he continued his research with people. Don't worry, he did not shock people. That's not how they did it. But what he found is something that shocked him and surprised him, and that is there was a category of people who never learned to be helpless. They always resisted. And he wondered why. And it led to an entire field of research. You'll hear a little bit about it more this afternoon when we talk about positive psychology. But what Seligman concluded is the people who resisted helplessness were what we would call optimists. And optimism is not something you're born with. It is a learned explanatory style. It's a style that you and I have all learned. When something happens to us, how do we explain what happened to us? The good news, because it's learned, is we can unlearn it. So I want to help you. I want to show you right now how to shift from being a pessimist in the face of a setback to being an optimist and what it comes down to. Here, it's very simple. What a pessimist does, when something negative happens to them, they say it's permanent. In their mind, the way they explain it to themselves, without challenging the story, is they say it's permanent. It's a recession, it'll always be this way. They don't really, I mean, it's not logical, right? But it's what we do. It's pervasive. It affects every area of my life, and it's personal. What's happening is my fault. It's because I'm not smart enough, not prepared enough, not whatever it is. That's what a pessimist does, and because of that, when something bad happens, it becomes catastrophic. Of course, it's permanent, it's global, and it's pervasive. Oh, that's terrible. I mean, it's personal. That's terrible, right? What an optimist does is the opposite of that. Something bad happens and they say, it's temporary, won't last. And, you know, it's specific, meaning it's not global across everything. It's specific to this one thing. And you know what? It's not personal. It's not my fault. Even if maybe it's not true, it's not my fault. So that's those three things. It's shifting from something bad happens, it's permanent, to it's temporary. It's global and pervasive to it's just this one thing. It's specific. And from it's personal, it's my fault, to it's not personal. I literally, 2-3 weeks ago, sat with the CEO of a major retail group. She had just taken over and, you know, she's facing a recession. And she was feeling terrible. I'm just the worst leader. Every part of the business is terrible. The results are terrible. And all I did was help her reframe it. I said, you know what? It's a recession. It's true. But guess what? It's not going to be a recession forever. It's going to come back up at some point. And you know, is it true that all parts of your business are equally bad, or are there some better parts of the business than others? And guess what? It's not your fault. You didn't lay the foundations of this recession. You couldn't have predicted it. You got put in right as it was happening. You know, I just watched her face brighten up as I told her that. And she was like, yeah, I can do this. And so it's really about challenging those stories that we have, arguing with those stories that we have, from making them permanent, pervasive, and personal to temporary, specific, and not personal. Maybe I'll just I'll close with a little bit of a story of how I apply these sustain tools. One of the sustain tools is, so I have a dirty secret about writing this book, right? So I've been working on this for like a decade. And I'm writing this book about uncertainty with my co-author, again, who is also my wife of 26 years. So, you know, there's great parts and there's parts where your partner can really challenge you. The pandemic hits and, all of my income is from speeches like this, from teaching in a university. And so all of my income disappeared in 5 days. I had a full calendar and it was gone. And you know, there was a threat about whether the university would even be able to stay afloat. So maybe I wouldn't even have that job. And I just bought an apartment. And I told my wife, as long as there's not a recession in the next year, we'll be fine. And look what happened. And so I was freaking out. I'm just going to skip through these to the final slide. I was freaking out. And she said to me, if you can't apply these tools to help yourself, I will not let you write this book. That was, great. Just like a partner to tell you how it is. It'd be too hypocritical. And so I was, she was right. And the next morning, I was staying up late, waking up early. I was so anxious. The next morning, I go down, and I'm in the kitchen, and I remember, one of the tools in sustain is to, instead of focusing on what you might lose because of the uncertainty, to focus on having gratitude for what you still have. And at that moment, I realized I was in the middle of grinding coffee beans. And they were so rich, so earth, that smell, that earthy, rich smell, I just smelled it. It smelled so good, so comforting. And then I noticed that the sunlight was coming in across the kitchen. And the morning was so beautiful. And then it occurred to me, what do I still have? I could lose it all. I could go bankrupt. I could lose the apartment. I could lose the job. I would still have this rich smell of coffee in the morning. I would still have this beautiful morning light. And if I'm lucky, I'll have the relationships with the people I love. And you know, the stress, it just fell off my shoulders. And so that's what I mean by sustain. Let me very quickly close, the book, The Upside of Uncertainty. I've told you 4 categories of things to do. Number 1, reframe in terms of the possibility, not just the uncertainty. You can acknowledge the uncertainty, but reframe in terms of the possibility. Number two, prepare, do things that will make you feel calm and comfortable, and we talked about uncertainty balancers. Number three, there's ways to take action that will lead to better outcomes. There's ways to do that will lead to better outcomes, and we talked about asking, how do I activate and unlock the possibility of what's there? And number four, how do you sustain yourself? And we talked about practicing learned optimism in the face of the events that happen to us. Thank you so much. If you want to find more about the book, found out more about the book, you can go to the website. Thank you.